afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Belkin Art Gallery. I'm Naomi Sawada, and thank you for coming on this beautiful fall day. Just a couple of housekeeping tips before we start. As you can see, Michael here, he is filming this event, and at some point it will be on a kiosk that people can see when they come into the gallery, as well as on the web. So if you do not wish to be on camera, please just be mindful of the camera's eye. And this event will be meant as a discussion, so please feel free to talk as we go through. This is the mic. There's also a mic also on the camera that you see there. I'm going to hand it over to Scott Watson.
Okay, well, welcome everybody on this beautiful day. Thanks for coming to our exhibition tour today and talk. Before I introduce Maria, I'd like to introduce our new Associate Director, Curator Lorna Brown. And Lorna will introduce the project that's concurrent with this one, which is in the Kerner Library.
Hi, thanks for coming. Pardon my cold, I don't usually talk like this. But I wanted to introduce Erdem Tajdalin, who's here. Say hi. And just to let people know that his project here is at the Kerner Library in the main floor. Just to, you know, 50 paces that way and enter through the front, the right to the back, and it's on a massive wall between the two elevators. It's a really fabulous project that where Erdem has composed very personal letters and then returned to those letters and edited them for syntax, logic, etc. It's a really lovely piece, and I thought it had a wonderful relationship to the kind of erasures and worrying activity that is evident in this project. So be sure to check that out afterwards or another time.
Thank you. Today, I'd like to, it's really my privilege to welcome Maria Eichhorn to the gallery and to have her give a tour of this show. I've known Maria since, I believe, 1987 or thereabouts, not as well then as I do now. And Maria's work is a work I esteem and value very, very much. It's work that it's hard to get categorized, and I won't really try, except to say that it would fall somewhere between the aftermath of conceptualism and institutional critique, and also somewhere else. We're showing two special ongoing projects in this exhibition, but this is only a small aspect of a practice that has many, many sides to it. Some of that's documented in books and in the vitrines. Just to give an example of the kinds of thing that Maria does, a gallery in Bern asked her to exhibit. They had an exhibition budget of 40,000 euros. I can't remember the exact amount. She noticed the building needed some repair. She used that money to repair the building and displayed the galleries as repaired with nothing else in them. So this was a gesture that was dialectical. It was both extremely generous and also totally withholding. And Maria's work has this dialectical capacity. Every work has that kind of progression in it. The work is often very politically pointed and astute. For the documenta of Oquianzor, Maria created a corporation with 50,000 euros that could not accrue capital. And this corporation, I think, is now residing in the ABBA Museum in Eindhoven. I could go on and describe other works, but I don't want to take too much of your time, and you can find out about these things in the displays. This project came to be through various conversations. I think Maria first visited the gallery 3 years ago with a project I cannot describe, which was too ambitious for us to actually do. It involved a considerable transformation of the gallery space. So in the end, we decided that we would show these two works, both of which have something to do with sex, representation, and censorship. And they're both works that change and augment every time they're shown. So that's the relationship between the two of them. So without further ado, let me introduce my friend, Maria Eichhorn.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thanks for coming. But this work is taking us if you want to understand the world, it's not necessary to watch a film, it's also possible to learn to watch a film. So it's very much up to approach your feasibility on that thing. The work was supposed to be done in 1999, four films, and each was the major of each book in which I think he was coming from. And there's a specific way of shooting the films, but also a close-up. The sexual practice is going to be a close-up, and it's very close. Comes very close to the body part of the action. And the films are close-up because one reason having no sound, no films is the work is not only the film, but the whole situation. And the situation, sound is part of the whole work. And so the films used for this show, the three new films, reading play, text play, and the new content, the new films.
Would you say that one of the impacts of your having done this work in society, some repercussions, some effect in society, broad views of it?
Some effect on society?
I'm
sure.
Yes.
Andrea, I have a question regarding your casting, how you cast your actors for the films. Curious as to, apart from obvious considerations, where you decided to have men together, women together, versus say a man and a woman or a man and a woman. So what decisions were formed, how you put certain genders together?
So I began with a whole heterosexual couple, so a woman and man, and the next shoot was a homosexual couple. No, a lesbian couple, and the third one was a homosexual couple. Then the fourth one was a woman, and so a woman, and the last one. The last couple was it's a couple of practice previous and practices. So we have to start the lexicon, we have to start somewhere and then go on and try to figure out what else is possible.
Are you concerned though about gender impacting the activity to create suppositions around gender or sexuality, homosexual behavior versus heterosexual behavior? Is that a concern? And I guess I extend that to questions of ethnicity as well, those concerns, how they would impact on the narratives that are within these educational films.
And the lexicon can never be too complete, that's why it's not, it's just a start or something. With different girls, you have to understand.
It's an endless project. Each time you show it, you add it. So I guess that allows for change and maybe addressing questions in mind for subsequent issues.
Yeah, sure.
So generally, to the dialogue, if it's not talking.
Are the people actors, or do you advertise for participants, or how do you
time different. You know, it was the first time, so it was a show at the body course in Frankfurt on Main. It's an institution connected to an art academy. And so we have put the website in the newspaper, and then we received 20 replies from Main. I think the gay people, gay, the homosexual people there, they said they are professional porn actors. Yeah. It looks perfect. And the last couple was also very, very professional. And they teach SN, and they write books about SN, BDSM, and they.
Like in the list here, they take the alphabetical order, it's sort of like a dictionary. And also kind of in the actual form of the videos, there's not really a sense of like an erotic climax or something. It's more, they almost look instructional, especially in the video like Japanese Bondage, that one particularly is like an instructional video, or sort of takes that form. So I guess I was wondering about kind of how you were thinking about maybe this is like a pedagogy or an education or like information. Does that make sense? I see it sort of as like an encyclopedia.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this implies a lexicon. Mm-hmm. Also, a lexicon implies information
I guess, do you see that sort of as like a tension with what we usually consider to be the erotic, pairing that with sort of a lexicon as this kind of contradictory form? And also the erotic is something that is typically like estranged or hidden or made private or something.
I think erotic is not always coming out of here because one person thinks libraries is a very erotic place. One other person library is very boring. Someone needs to go somewhere to have sex or it's so much depends on how you see something. And I guess it can be erotic as anything else or not. Even one girl can be erotic or not.
Would you be able to tell us a bit about having the projectionist present or the dynamic between the viewer and the projectionist and how that element works in this project? I was asking a question about the projectionist being present and the role of the projectionist and the role of the viewer. And I guess like two forms of projection that are maybe underway in the work, and also neutrality of the sort of clinical educational side of it as well. So some presumptions of neutrality of the service side of the project.
And then the projectionist is just there to screen the films. Someone wants us to see the film. I like the situation that that something is shown to you, so you, it's just for you, you know, then the keyword comes and the visitor is asking for something, and it's just for it's like a service, and like something you just made for you, and then but the projectionist doesn't need to speak or to talk about something. It's not a job to explain the work or to say something more about it.
Why didn't you shoot practices on film?
Something?
Yeah.
Instead of video or something like that. So this gives the work I cannot be digitalized. Like, it needs to be so complicated. So it's a very more old-fashioned technique. Like as I said, I like the situation that you come to a place and then it's just shown for you. And I also like the situation that so different from other artworks, from other video or from other film works, it's not projected when you enter the space. So, I mean, I really like the situation that you have to ask for something and you have to decide what to see. And because it's the same, for me it's the same not to ask, but also to ask for something that the work completely works without projection. Because it's completely up to you to decide. And if you don't want to see something, it's perfect. And it's the same like if you want to see something. I think it's an interesting way to be different from all other film artists or video artists. That's why I have chosen this. So, what was that?
I'm wondering, I mean, I understand that Reich was testing the orgasm, and I'm wondering if you could talk about your thoughts on the orgasm vis-a-vis this, because I haven't seen them all and I don't know the effect behind it, but that's what I was understanding, and maybe I'm wrong, but could you talk a bit about Reich, the relationship between your piece and Reich's obviously unseeable work? Am I wrong? Because I understood that there. I was just asking. I assumed that there was a direct relationship to Willem Reich's burned films. Am I?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry. He worked with a team and they did a whole series, a lexicon of sexual practices. And from what I understand, it was to understand the orgasm, but through multiple practices, and the Nazis burned everything.
Yeah.
And he was in, I think he was Anaheim or something. He was in California at the time with Marcuse. And this is what I understand. I could be wrong. So sorry, I just assumed this, there was like a kind of direct.
So what are your nouns and lexicon of practices?
Why?
Yeah, sexual practices have to be verbs, so they're nouns.
Because it's a sexual lexicon.
Really?
Because it is a lexicon of sexual practices.
But like, usually it's an action, like a practice is an action, as opposed to a noun? Say if somebody said, what's your favorite sexual practice? You say I, and you say an I doing something, or something to do with I, for example.
I, so that's what you mean. this is why, because a lexicon always has kind of underlines, like if you go to Wikipedia, you see the term, and in the description or in the definition of the term, you have a lot of other words. Which link again to something else. And this is how I understand it. So what does it you describe a practice? Is it sound strange?
Just
go
through
it. What does it describe a practice? And that in one sentence, the term ear pops up, and that the ear is also linked to something else. That's how I understand it. It's one explanation. Is it okay?
I think I may be referring to, like, the only verb I see is kissing.
Licking.
Like actions as.
Yeah, like licking, kissing, masturbation, plays. These are all actions, right?
Yeah.
So practice sort of a verb of an action.
Yeah.
As opposed to a noun. Right? Our inlet is an action. A clitoris, ear, eyes, feet. Lacious an action. Mouth. These are all noun. But probably from something that's happened.
That's how only a lexicon works. So we won't have many undertones and undertones relate to one again. But it's really a very widespread.
Hi, Maria. My name is Benjamin. I really appreciate you answering questions like that. It's an interesting way of doing an artist talk. I want to ask you a question that might seem convoluted, but it's quite simple. I want to ask you a question about praxy, but maybe more about practice and your link with the institution. And Scott mentioned this kind of personal approach and your, you know, own relationship of working with an institution and maybe consider the work to be displayed. And I see that in your practice, there is a lot of tension between the act or practice, for example, a sexual practice, and a kind of institutional concealment or action in regards with that practice. So in your own practice, right, when you approach an institution, how do you deal with that kind of institutional, like from a, I'm an artist as well, so I'm kind of curious about that. So in terms of, you know, how is it for you to work with institutions?
Yeah, I always try to start and conceal.
No, there's no either impulse or curiosity or.
So I start from conceal, or no, how can I say that? Tell me about the method. I don't know the method.
Okay. Sounds good. Yeah,
thank you.
Then you maybe. So I could give you an example,
I can explain how I approach a certain
institution.
Oh, yeah, an example would be great, but I don't know your practice enough to ask you a specific example. Maybe you can, you know.
I mean, you stay with this example here. So I came 5 years ago to visit the Belkin Gallery, and there was so I made a proposal, but it didn't work out. And then Belkin, they bought a performance of the one series. And I think Scott was always interested in these concrete imports works. And then he also liked this work. And if they proposal doesn't work, I mean, if one proposal is not possible to do, it's not feasible, then I'm very open for suggestions by the curators or the museum directors. But this is kind of a decision between both of us.
Would you feel comfortable sharing what your original proposal idea was, or is that not even worth discussing?
Yeah, of course, that's what I can speak about.
It's up to you.
Yeah, there was a tunnel to do that tunnel. And if you didn't hear about this tunnel, one of these Canadian, it was 1 year ago, it was about
at the border of BC.
Yes. There was this tunnel, I was always interested in the underground. And I thought a tunnel would be more interesting to hear it, but it was not feasible. Maybe later.
The tunnel was going to go from the gallery, first of all, to the Asian campus. And simultaneously, at the end of each day, the dirt from one extraction would be put near the other pole. So there would be this exchange all the time. So I read the work as being metaphorical, a lot of things that go on at the university. So And we got very far with it. We actually interested the mine, Department of Mining in doing it. But when it costed out and all the safety things came to be, it was just too monumental for us. That's just what happened. So it was a great, great project.
But not after we know about this case, it will
just come. We're talking about the young man who built a tunnel near North University for his own amusement. Maybe you know that was in the news last year. Mm-hmm. Yes, so Maria thought of, heard about that story and reminded her of our unrealized needs.
But
we
could invite him to do
it here. Yes, exactly. Maria, do you want to talk about the other
workshop? Yes. And I did for a show in a gallery in Tokyo. And so I have sent books from those in Tokyo in the years 2000 until 2002. On the assumption that the custom that the Tokyo Narita Airport would open the buses and send some books. And after a while, they sent some one package and many books sent it, like the Metal Floor book. But what is shown in Tokyo, I have only chosen one of the sent books. It was the Metal Floor book. You can see that the kind of documentation. And I added many other books like media books and law books and books about legal cases, about censorship and so I think 5 years after this show, it was 2003 in Tokyo, I decided to show this work again in the gallery and. And because in the case in this between, you can only see one page of the censorship. I decided to take photographs of all censored pages in the book. I think there are 19 pages, and as a kind of documentation, as you can see here. And you know, so I kept all these sets of books in storage until like this year because I have 10 books censored beside this level book. And for this show, it's the first time I made new photos of a book, photos by Termans and Jeff Holmes and there was one book about the Kinsey Institute. Okay, so, and what can I say?
Can you talk about the mark making and your attempt to see if you could find who the censors were?
Yes, I can talk about it. At the customs.
Yeah.
At the customs. So for instance, this piece of paper is one of the notes sent to the gallery by the customs to say if you want to get the books, that they would need to be censored, and if you don't want them censored, they need to go back to Berlin. And because it was my idea to have them censored, so they made, I think, they time. And we tried to make a documentation about the process of censorship, of the censor method, but it was not possible. So I guess it could be a kind of eraser pen, and to take off the color of the print, but also a kind of a little bit of paper in the book.
We can
able to understand the logic of what where the mark making began and ended in each book? Was there a logic to it, or was every image marked?
Yes, and so they're very careful and they're very meticulous, and they all images. They made a sense of all images. They want to make sense. They didn't overlook. A single image.
You can see there's different styles. So sometimes what they're blocking out are a penis and a vagina, basically. Especially if those are if there's penetration. But so some of them there's just a like this. There's it's very abstract, whatever. Others you see, especially you can see in one of the large ones, that the shape of the penis is still there. It's been carefully kept, but it's been whited out. So my response to it is that this style of censorship is really kind of mysterious because it, you know, to a Western eye, a nimbus around the body is like a halo. It's like it's something sacred, something transcendental is occurring. And that's how I don't think so. It's hard not to read them that way. But I don't think that censorship is intended to do that. So it's just not.
Yeah, I was going to ask something along those lines, because I was sort of reading the whiting out as, I think it's on black and white film, a lot of pieces as sort of like another light source. So I guess I was wondering how you understood erasure in this case as it related to censorship, because erasure in this case doesn't seem like a taking away or a removing, but sort of like a la Derrida, it's this additive process that occurs.
Yes, so I see these kind of drawings. I mean this information is removed, but another kind of information is added to the image.
So for you, it's a source of information, I guess?
Yes. It's an information about censorship, about the method of censorship, and of the information, the image information of a sexual image is taken away, is erased. So information replaces information.
You said that you knew in advance that the censors would censor the images somehow. Was it clear? So I guess I have a two-part question. First of all, was it clear how? Did you know in advance that you'd seen other censored images prior to the ones that you sent from Berlin? Was it a consistent style again in those images, if indeed you'd seen those before?
Yeah, I've seen this kind of thing in Lightroom, Japanese Lightroom. And anyone one day they would do it. And this style, for bigger pieces, it's a bigger kind of a pen, razor pen, or rubber pen. And for they are very tiny pieces, I couldn't watch the method and the process. So I'm not really sure. I can only assume they use a kind of rubber pen or something. But when you see the original books, it's funny. You see all these kind of little pieces of paper and in the book.
Why are the photographs of the books the artwork and not the books themselves?
The books themselves, two books in this case, in this vitrine, and you can only see one image, because it's like those between. And I regard this photograph as a kind of documentation, but also as a work itself, as a work for itself, standing for itself. So you could also do films, for instance. I was thinking about filming, and maybe I will do it some one day to film the details or to make other photographs, because this is one of those, it's, you know, the format is one-to-one. It's like the original book. And I like the idea to have an image of a book which looks like the book, the real book. So some people would think the book is inside this case, inside this frame.
I have another question. It's funny because in the other room we have to ask to view the film, and here we see the books as an image, or they are in a cabinet, another iteration. Do you have work where the viewer actually touch the thing, or is there always a mediation between an object and the viewer, and the viewer is really the viewer?
Like here, it's only the viewer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But in your practice, is it important that the viewer walk through or sees, and there's this kind of mediation between either with the frame, the cabinet, the projectionist, or is it?
I don't see so much differences between works, conventional artworks, or like the photographs, for instance, and the other work. Because I think as soon as a viewer looks at a work, it's an interaction, and the viewer makes the work always in the art. Mm-hmm. But just little differences in certain artworks. There's always an interaction. So that the work looks at you, and you look at the work.
Or not, in the case of the film, some people choose not to look, right?
Yeah, but then you look at the text, or then you look at the shelf or something else.
Were all the works that you sent to Japan artworks or photographs done by men?
No.
What were some of the other books that we're not seeing here in the room? Many of these gatherings.
So, for instance, a book titled Erotica. It's a kind of old-fashioned book, and it has a lot of images in it. I think 200 images to a center. So, Erotica. And then another book by a young woman, female photographer. And I wanted to include it in the show, but there was not much space enough, and there were many, many photos, many more photographs.
Did you consider a book like Nan Golden's Ballad of Sexual Dependency as a book to send? And I ask because it's quite a formed scene that runs through the book, but there is explicit scenes in it, but they're quite, they're not forward, they're kind of here and there. It would be a challenge for maybe a censor to find them, but nonetheless they're there.
Mm-hmm.
So do you know that book, and would that be a book that you would consider?
Of course, sure.
I was curious.
Yeah. There's many more books which could be included.
Yeah.
This series is also not limited, I mean, so it can be endless.
Yeah.
Can continue. It's a good question because you know, these photographs were chosen for many artists. So people come for this presentation today. But as I said, it's not an unlimited series.
Has the criteria changed at all over the course of the project? Like the legal criteria for the censors in Japan? Like, have those laws remained consistent?
I think so.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Have you sent more books since that period between 2000 and 2002, or is that? You haven't sent any more books.
Like many more books.
You have. You continue to send
many more books. Well, this book you can see at least what I have sent.
I'm curious about how in the U.S. images of young children are censored. Sally Mann is the obvious example, and wondering if
if the same problem happens in Japan, if an unsexual image of a child would be censored.
I'm sure.
Forgive my ignorance here, but you only sent these books to Japan? So have you thought about sending such books to other countries or continents or locales and what that would mean? I mean, my assumption is that I don't know censorship laws in Canada and the United States that well, though I think it's typically the case that they are just not allowed into the country, so there's no visible record of the censoring, and so I think that that's what you seem to be more interested in, is the visibility of that censorship. So what happens, censorship elsewhere? How is it visible and invisible? Or the other example I was thinking of is not necessarily pornographic imagery or sexual imagery, but like in Germany, Leni Riefenstahl's films are not allowed. So what, that's like a different kind of censorship, and what that implies.
Okay, this work is a kind of starting point for further examination of this censorship itself. And you can include any other countries, text censorship, and very much as a starting point.
Would they have a different lexicon then, you imagine?
I can tell you what happens in Canada, because I was an expert witness for the Little Sister States. You may not know about this, but there's a gay bookstore in Vancouver for almost 12 years they were persecuted. The customs would seize books coming to them, and they just, when the books are seized, they're just seized. You can start court action to try and get them, but it's pretty hard. So other bookstores would participate by ordering the same books, and they would only see them in the way they But they seized them and destroyed them. They didn't alter them in any way. So that's the Canadian practice.
Yeah.
And the Canadian censorship regime is based around something called the Butler decision. I'm not sure all the details of that. But Andrew Borkin was an expert witness for the Crown. So anything in Canada that's thought to be degrading is prohibited. So that includes lots of forms of S&M and stuff like that. So things that were being seized by customs or Little Sisters were things like Tom of Finland, if you can believe it, and cartoons, S&M cartoons. Like there's a cartoon anthology called Meat Man. I was seized. I spent many hours trying to explain to her why this stuff was on it. So.
But the problem is that we can't support the film export to Japan, to
Canada. I don't think there's any issues. Needle play might cause an issue, but I doubt it, because it's so abstract.
Yeah, but the needle play, what's the law? No.
I think
because
it was for the
video,
it was difficult
to see.
Yeah, actually, that actually never occurred to you.
Another question is, did you have difficulties to show your work somewhere else? Did you experience censorship yourself? But, you know, not voluntary censorship, I would say.
Isn't that my own book? Sure. I mean, not obviously in the show, but often before a show, on the proposals, there's something and things like that.
Do you consider that as part of the same series as this book that is, you know, ever extended? You include also involuntary censorship, or is it just the voluntary censorship that are part of that series?
Is the censorship always involuntary?
No, because you describe this work
as this kind of starting point for many of the pieces that might include text and images. And my question is, do you include involuntary censorship, right? Censorship that you didn't thought or you wanted a work to be shown in a place, but that couldn't be shown. Do you include that kind of censorship as a work of art, or is it excluded from the series?
I mean, if I would want to find a form for it, then it would be a part of the work. As an artist, you always need to find a form for something, you know? You have an idea, then you have to visualize it or do something. But it would be strange to say all the kind of censorships in the whole world is part of my work.
It would be strange.
Yeah, it would be strange, but I mean, if you reduce it only to the term censorship, just to the word, then you can include all kind of, all censorships in the world.
Was the text censorship also erasure, or was it more like redacted?
I think it's also, as I know, text censorship, it's made with a black pen, because it's lines, normally lines, and then you just go over with a black edge pen.
Yeah. And was there sort of like a sense of antagonism at all, or was it kind of just like a procedural thing for the border?
It was just a procedural, and like I said, it costs like €2,000
and so on. Uh-huh. You might not know this, but is it sort of for the labor of the censors, so you're kind of paying for them to do this process?
Yeah, I think it's like, I'm not sure about this, I don't know much about it, but it's like a bureaucratic process. I think they explained, if you want to have this book censored, then you have to pay a certain fee for whatever.
Question, which kind of comes, I think, and I'm trying sort of form it as I go along, but it kind of coming out of Kika's question, which is that there's something about the way that these works have to do with, they're coming from a place, so it sounds like they're coming from Berlin and going to Japan in order for them to be produced. They need to sort of be able to be made in one country or kind of be acceptable at some level. And I'm just wondering about, have you considered then, so Kika brought up kind of borderline images of like naked children or that kind of thing, but like what about, how would it change the stakes of it if you took something that was not possible to be, or kind of like other types of imagery that was problematic or more problematic in the country of origin, or how does, there seems like there's some kind of like that issue of, I'm not able to fully explain what I'm thinking, but there seems like there's some kind of dynamic there that's about, I don't know, is that enough to go on as a question, or is it just a dynamic that's key to respond to?
Your keyword there is
I could try. Are you asking what would happen if, or why not, question?
It's sort of a why not, I guess, because it feels like the stakes are different for you when, if you're sending something from Berlin to Japan, where it's accept, where like a Robert Mapplethorpe book is totally sort of acceptable and available in bookstores, they're uncensored. Mm-hmm. Has it ever seemed like it would be important or to change the stakes or change the dynamic by finding something that was not acceptable or censored in, or is there something where you could kind of like short circuit or change that?
Would you use material that would be illegal in Germany? That's the question.
That's the question?
Yeah.
Thank you, Scott.
Would it change the stakes of the project in any way? I mean, that is not even But isn't it sort of like where desire and economy, like the sexual economy and desire being the economy, and how that in terms of either it's like the state or it's the institution purchasing three films made by you, the artist, of others. but yeah, I was interested in how we sort of like desiring institutions with desiring states. And the consumption of desire as one, and how that sort of all collapsed into if it's artistic work, if it's sex work, and then sort of these like the material itself being thrown. And I just wonder in terms of reading, actually having read the statement about sort of abstraction. Money or class work in terms of the reservation, so like peddling it like that, money at no whatever. So I was wondering in terms of this question, this observation that, I don't know, I guess maybe the work isn't so much about the censorship, but about the ways that desire and capital play out, how these sort of like exchanges between artists, institutions, the state, the economy, and sort of just. Maybe more than them in terms of having folks purchased, why the institution bringing folks
that don't do that. Well, the prints are not social
purchases. No. But yeah, it's a manipulation of sex acts that it's sort of pretty easy in terms of thinking about that as like artistic work or sex work. So it's not really hard to go through that. Which I think would be really interesting. So money moving, phallus being
moved. It's interesting.
Yeah, there's also the phallus with these is like the phallus only, the phallus is not in images, right? So that's really interesting. Beautiful the drawings for sure.
Have Tillman's or Goons seen these versions of their books?
Maybe it's called that? I don't know. I mean, it's the first time that it's interesting. I don't want to have a top court, and I'm sure they're not here.
Sorry, they haven't been reproduced in one of the you've never shown them the original ones?
No. I don't know them.
Well, thank you, Marie. Thank you very much.